Hello, this is Stéphanie, and this is the recording of the session number 3, the theoretical part. It's a first for me, so please be kind to me when you look at this video. I often do video in French for my clients, but it's first time for me to record a video for you, so I count on you to be kind. When you look at this video. So today we discussed together about storytelling, and I want to comment a little bit the documents I shared with you during our Zoom session. So the first discussion we had was about Marina Abramović TED Talk, and you were quite enthusiastic, in fact, to debrief about it and to share your comments, etc. And what we summarized together was that we can analyze the video and the story that is told by Marina Abramović on different level. At different level, we can just focus on the content. So what she's sharing with us. We can pay attention to how she expresses herself and how she behaves on the stage, and what are the behaviors, the attitude, the movement. And we saw that she doesn't move that much, but she's quite stable, but she uses her voice and her emotion. She's showing her emotion and her vulnerability to the public so that the connection is quite strong. So that was interesting to see that we have different level to analyze the story told by Marina Abramović. And this leads to a slide telling a story. And I was sharing with you that there are a few things to keep in mind when we prepare a story. The one point is why you want to tell this story. What is your goal? What is your purpose behind telling this story? That's the first point. I don't know if it's an order, but the second point you can think about is how you write it. What is the format? What is the vocabulary? What is the style? What is the structure? How you think about the different stage of your story, the format of the story. The third point is how you deliver it, meaning the language, the hands. You see that I speak a lot with my hands, that's very French. The confidence that she expressed, the vulnerability, how she allows, as someone in the class said, how she allows the audience to see her. So that's her body language. And finally, there's a very important point for sure, which is the content. What you tell, what is the story, how much is it, how simple is it to understand, how complex, etc., etc. So four levels, why you tell it, so the purpose, how you write it, the format, the vocabulary, etc., how you deliver it, and especially the body language, the hands, the tone of voice, the confidence you express with your body, and finally, the content, and four levels of preparation that we can do when we are about to tell a story. So then we shared the definition of storytelling, and we noticed that it's not only telling a story, but this story is sometimes part of our culture, sometimes delivered with improvisation, theatrics, embellishment. And we understood as well together that every culture has its own story or narratives that are shared as means of entertainment, education, cultural preservation, instilling moral values, sharing the collective intelligence, the collective memory that we have together. So stories are super important, and we know that before having books and be able to write, our culture, human cultures, were already saying stories, and the word of mouth was extremely important already. Then I propose you a little detour to neuroscience, and I was talking to you about oxytocin. Oxytocin is a hormone produced by our brain that plays a role in our social attitudes. And it contributes to make us care about others. So for instance, oxytocin is super important in the relationship between the baby and the mother, because the baby cannot survive without a mother, a caring person, to take care of him and nourish him and making sure that he's safe. So in the caregiver, oxytocin plays a very important role. Our brain is producing this oxytocin that will incite us to take care of the baby, to make sure that he survives. And so this oxytocin, if we make an image, we call it the cuddle hormone sometimes. We could say that this hormone, this neurochemical, sends a signal in our brain. It's safe to approach someone else, this person, other. Okay? And why am I making this detour? It's because I have shared with you a result of research that was led by Paul Zak, who is a neuroeconomist, so the first scientist to combine neuroscience and economy. And he has studied with his students and his lab the impact of character-driven stories on the will of people to donate, to contribute financially to a project. So this research was led with two different groups of people. One group was exposed to a video with a character-driven video, so people explaining why it would be important to donate and showing people in the video. And at the end of this video, the people were asked, "Would you like to donate, to contribute, to help these people?" The second group of people was, sorry, the second group of people was exposed to a video explaining why they should donate, for which result, without showing any character, any people, any person. And same thing, after the video, they were asked to donate. And the conclusion of the research shows that people exposed to a character-driven video produce more oxytocin, so their oxytocin was analyzed after the video, and they were as well willing to donate more often and more to contribute. Okay? So we see that oxytocin, I mean, sorry, character-driven video and stories lead to more care for others. There are other research as well that show that, but this is this one that I wanted to share with you. And I put in the file the reference of the article that you can consult. This article was published by Harvard Business Review in 2015. The next point of our presentation today was about the structure of a story, a narrative. I was telling you that it's quite important to have a structure. So I propose to you the seven-step drama structure that was used quite a long time in stories, since the ancient Greek were already using a kind of story like that in the Greek dramaturgy. And it was formalized by Gustav Freytag, who is a German novelist of the 19th century. And he was explaining that there are seven steps. First step is exposition. That means that you have to just set the scene, explain what is the context so that your audience can understand where are the characters, what is the purpose, what is the context. No? That's first point. Then you need, the second point is an inciting accident or incident, sorry, because it's not always an accident. So inciting incident. So there's something that happens that creates a change and that opens the story and creates a tension. Then third point is rising action. So your main character, for instance, you can have obstacles, there are things that happen, etc. It leads to a kind of crisis, which is the fourth level. And then the tension reaches its maximum and it's the climax. And then this climax is as well the turning point. And at this moment, the main character starts to understand how to solve the problem or the issue or the crisis. And then the falling action shows how the solution is coming, the character resolves the difficulties step by step. And finally, we have what we call in French dénouement, which means ending. And this ending can be a happy ending, if it's a comedy, for instance, or it can be a sad ending if it's a drama. No? So that's, and you can think about movies that you like. Very often you will recognize these different steps in the movie or in the series as well, very often as well. No? So I invite you to look at the advertising. I have put a link in the presentation for an advertising that was published during the Super Bowl 2016 by Hyundai, and it's a very typical way to build an ad with this seven-step drama. So in the file you will find the description of the seven steps quite precisely, and then I'm sharing as well, still inspired by movie, because movies, storyboard artists are the one to really use this tension to create interest of the audience for their movie. So inspired by a storyboard artist from Pixar, I extracted seven rules that I share with you now. First of all, great stories are universal. Everyone can relate to it. Everyone can recognize, rebound, understand what it means and what it is about. That's first point. The second point, great stories have a clear structure. The third point, great stories have a purpose. Why do we tell it? What goal do we want to reach? Fourth point, great stories have a character to root for. And in this case, because we are talking in this class about storytelling about yourself, you will be the hero or the heroine of this story. The fifth rule is great stories appeal to our deepest emotions. We have already discussed that together and noticed that together as well in the session before, that emotions are a facilitator to create connection between people. So your story need to appeal to our emotions. The sixth rule is great stories are surprising and unexpected. So we need something to create excitement, to create surprise. We want, when we meet people, we want to be surprised by others, right? Seventh, great stories are simple and focused. And this is extremely important. Sometimes you don't need to go to too much detail. you need to ask yourself, is this detail important for the story and the purpose I'm pursuing? If not, forget it. Keep it simple. You need to be able to, as an audience, you need to be able to follow the story. So it has to be simple and to be focused as well, because you have a purpose. So you build your story to reach this purpose. And finally, I would add one rule that is really my vision and that is, in my opinion, extremely important, especially when you talk about yourself. Great stories about yourself are authentic and believable. So it's really important that when you tell your story, you're confident, you can share with emotions and create great share important things for you and important things for your audience, but this has to be believable. Okay? So that was our first part. And in the file, you will find the detail of the 22 rules for great stories by Emma Coates, who is this Pixar storyboard artist. So that was our first part and then the next step was to ask you to draw your life or a part of your life, a story of your life, or a section in a 7-step dramatic structure, to draw it on paper and then to share with one of you or two of you so that you can explore a different way to talk about yourself. And we made a debrief of that together. And I hope that you will share with me your drawings, because I'm very curious to see and to hear about it. So that was it. Then we moved to a different moment. And this moment was to talk about your why. So you watched, prior to this session, you watched Simon Sinek TED Talk that is called Start With Why. And this is a very famous TED Talk. I don't know if you have seen it, but it has millions of views. And Simon shares with us that you can say what you do, or you can start with why you do it. And in his experience and observation and research, is demonstrating that starting with why you do things is much more appealing, interesting, teasing the interest of your audience. And that's what we have worked on together in the second part of this class. So I summarized the example, the case study of Apple that Simon is sharing in his talk, and he says, okay, we can say the story of Apple two ways. One is, Apple makes great computers. The Apple computers are simple, beautifully designed, and easy to use. That's one way to tell the story. And another one is this. In everything we do, we believe in challenging the status quo. We believe in thinking differently. The way we challenge the status quo is by designing beautiful, simple, and easy to use products. We make computers. So I let you reflect on which way is the most appealing for you, which one leads you to buy Apple computer or Apple Watch or iPhone. What would be interesting, by the way, is to think about someone who is quite famous for his contribution to, I don't know, the world, the reflection, maybe a political leader or, I don't know, someone that you admire. And think about how you would understand and try to summarize their why. That could be an interesting reflection to answer to one of you who was saying during the class, it's quite difficult to imagine the why of a person, of me as a person. It's easier to understand that a company needs to have a why that is super clear so that everyone in the company can contribute and work in the same direction and build together based on the same value and mission. So you need to make this exercise for you. And I can tell you that I show you the book. This is the book, the workbook by Simon Sinek. And he explains how to find your why when you're a person and when you're a company. Maybe I can share with you a little bit more or send you a few pages of this book so that you have a better idea of this for yourself. Anyway, one important point to have in mind is that your why is not a statement about who you aspire to be, who you dream to be, a bigger you. It has to express who you are at your natural best. That means that your why is already inside you. Your why is already visible in the way you relate to others, in the way you contribute. You are a group member, for instance, or a fellow student. It's already present. It's just that we need to dig a little bit and reflect a little bit and try to make it more visible and conscious. It's really important that it's really authentic and that it's really related to you, the person you are. I shared with you the structure of the why, giving you detail. First of all, the why. What is it? The why is a solid belief. It's a kind of commitment. It's a vision of the world. The how is your own way to act according to this belief. And the what is the product, the output, the result, the impact that you have following this purpose and this specific way to act according to this purpose. A possibility to reflect on your why statement is to formulate it this way, to say, okay, my why is the following, to blah blah blah, and this blah 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 is your contribution, so that blah blah blah, and this second blah 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 is your impact. Okay? So, this I really advise you to look again in the file at this page, which is page number 25 or 26, that will show you how to formulate it. And this why statement has to be simple and clear, actionable, focused on the effect you have on others, and expressed in positive language that resonates with you. And then I propose that for 10 minutes, you take 10 minutes to write your why in the two different ways. One is to blah blah blah, my contribution, so that blah blah blah, my impact. Or second vision, second way, without think, sorry, second way, in everything I do, I believe in blah blah blah. The way I concretely translate this belief is by blah blah blah, and I do blah blah blah. And this is your métier, your occupation, your trade. Okay? So I think that's about it. As a form of conclusion, I was telling you that storytelling about yourself is extremely important because you need to have a written story, a kind of biography or a synthetic paragraph in your resume, a little bit of description in your about section in your LinkedIn profile, maybe your own presentation in your portfolio site or on your on your Instagram, for instance. So written story is quite important. It's very different according to the medium you will use, but it's important. And a verbal story as well is important when you talk about yourself, when you are pitching, when you meet professionals, your teacher, your parents' friends, etc. To have this capacity to present yourself with confidence is quite important, because that's how we relate to others and how we can share our professional ambition. So would you have any questions? Please come back to me using my email, and I will be more than happy to share more with you. Okay? See you guys. See you next week on Tuesday. In the meantime, don't forget to work on your homework. I will be very happy and interested to read your production. Bye-bye. See you guys.